Right, good morning, church family. I want to ask you to find a Bible, turn to the 19th Psalm as we continue our journey through the book of Psalms. So go ahead and find Psalm 19. I also want to ask you to take the worship folder that you received on your way in. If you would please first take out the Connect card insert. If you're a guest of ours this morning, we want to welcome you to Chapin Baptist. And if you need a church family, we'd love to get acquainted. So would you please consider putting your contact information on the front? And then as we always ask every week of every member or guest on the back of the card, we'd love to know how we can be praying for you and your family. I do want to encourage you, maybe consider keeping this card nearby during the sermon, maybe letting the message inform a way that we can be praying for you. I'd love to see how maybe you can see how God's word could be informing your heart's desire for certain prayers to be met. So just kind of keep this handy. Let me also ask you just to look in the bulletin announcements. There are several things being highlighted. I want to mention At the Gate. It's coming up soon, men. You are all invited Thursday, July 20th at 7 p.m. for a worship gathering of men. Doug will be preaching. This is the second At the Gate gathering. Very excited about this ministry. Got to be honest, I'm jealous, because I'm not going to be able to be there. I'm going to be in Brazil. So I'm starting to take this personally, because the first time they had it, I was in Brazil. The second time they scheduled it, I'm in Brazil. So I'm going to have to confront them about this pattern that I see. But men, I want to ask you to mark July 20th on your calendar and go and be fed by a brother in Christ with the Word of God. Also notice fall retreat coming up for men's ministry. Notice fall conference coming up. I'm probably going to mention those as well during the message. And it is that time. I must do this every week. VBS. Read about it. Register your kids. Pray for it. Ask Nikki Handelin how you might be able to help her getting ready for it. We are excited about that gospel opportunity. Now, here's what I want to do this morning. With Psalm 19, I hope to persuade you. I want to persuade you in three ways. I want to persuade you to see God's creative words. I want to persuade you to savor God's active word. I want to persuade you to seek God's redemptive words through Psalm 19. Let me just say that over just kind of so you can get a feel for it. I want to persuade you to see God's creative words, to savor God's active word, and to seek God's redemptive words. I want to ask if you'll bow with me in prayer, and then afterwards we will get into our text. Lord, these are your words. Lord, I know that we are reminded of that every week, and still somehow I fear that we're too used to it. I fear that we could even take it for granted, and I pray that you will not let us do that this morning. Don't let us take church for granted. Don't let us take Sunday morning, the weekly reminder of your resurrection, for granted. Don't let us take for granted the Bible that we are able to bring with us. So help us to hear and help us to see. God, if we don't hear and see from Psalm 19, how could we ever hope to hear or see in any other way? So we beg of you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to see God's creative words as presented to us in verses 1 through 6. This is a psalm written to the choir master. It's a psalm of David. He writes this: "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words, whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. We will come back to those verses in a few moments. I hope you will be persuaded to see God's creative words as they are presented to us in Psalm 19, verses 1 through 6. Furthermore, I hope you are persuaded to savor God's active word as we see it presented in verses 7 through 11. Follow along. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. So I want you persuaded to see God's creative words in verses 1 through 6, to savor God's active word in verses 7 through 11, and then finally, I hope you're persuaded to seek God's redemptive words as we find them in verses 12 through 14. Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. So all I've done so far is tell you what I hope to do. I hope to persuade you with Psalm 19 to see God's creative words, to savor God's active word, and to seek God's redemptive words. Now, let me try to persuade you. Church family, brothers and sisters in Christ, friends, guests, I want you to look to the skies to ponder the weight of God. I use the word weight because that's what the word glory means. Psalm 19 talks about the glory of God. That's the weight of God. The heavens declare the glory of God. The sky above proclaims his handiwork. This reminds us of Psalm 8:3, where David is pondering the sun and the moon and the stars and how God can create all these things and yet be mindful of mankind. The way David writes verse 1, he puts in the center the glory of God and his handiwork. He's wanting us to realize that as we look at creation, we are seeing a display of God's glory, his weight. He says, day to day, it pours out speech. It bubbles over with speech. Night to night reveals knowledge. It unfolds understanding. Then he explains in verse 3, there is no speech, nor are there words, whose voice is not heard. I will be honest, I preach from the ESV, the English Standard Version. I do believe that the way it's translated in verse 3 can be misunderstood. What David is saying is, there is no literal speech. He knows that. There are no literal words. He's saying, their literal voice, it's not heard. The way that you're hearing my words, my speech, my voice right now, he's acknowledging this is not how we hear the declaration of the heavens or the proclamation of the sky. It's different. But nevertheless, he says in verse 4, their voice goes out through all the earth. Another interesting piece of the text in verse 4, this word for voice, it's a different word. Actually, it's a word for the idea of line, like a measurement. We just sang about not being able to fathom the greatness, the depth, the glory of God. He says their line goes through all the earth. The measurement of this proclamation extends through all the earth, their words to the end of the world. Then he focuses on the sun, as we'll see in a moment. First, I want you to look to the skies to ponder the weight of God. The stars, moon, planets, clouds, thunderstorms. You're seeing a display of the greatness, the glory, the majesty, the weight of God. I got on the internet the other day to learn some more cool things about the universe. Let me give you some of these cool things about the universe according to the internet. These are all quotations. I assure you, this is not my original material. 1 million Earths could fit inside the sun. Ponder that. 1 million. And as a reminder, the sun is considered an average-sized star. Or how about this fact? There are more stars in the universe than grains of sand on all the beaches on Earth. Which, by the way, is at least 1 billion trillion. Now, to me, that begs the question, who bothered to try to estimate the count of sand? But someone did. And they're claiming that there are more stars. How about this fact? It would take, matter of fact, let me ask as a question for you to guess. How long do you think it would take to get in a modern spacecraft, a modern rocket ship, and reach the center of our galaxy, just ours, the Milky Way galaxy? How long do you think it would take to travel in a rocket ship to the center of the galaxy? You are right if you said it would take 450 million years. To get to the center of our galaxy. Or how about this? A neutron star. I've got to ask, does anybody even know what a neutron star is and willing to admit it in public? Okay, a neutron star is when a supergiant star collapses on itself. That's my way to explain it. Supernova, massive. Epically big supergiant star, I believe that is literally a category, supergiant, collapses, the core of the mass of that star collapses into a neutron star, which according to Wikipedia would be roughly 12 miles across. Now think about how much of a collapse that is, the size of a giant star collapsing into just several miles of mass. That neutron star spins at a rate, on average, of 600 times per second. I just got to read it again. The sky above proclaims his handiwork. The heavens declare the glory of God. The fastest spinning neutron star, which is known as PSR J1748-2446 AD, and the AD is a lowercase, if you're taking notes. The fastest one rotates at a rate of 716 times a second, or roughly 43,000 revolutions per minute. One more fact. Neutron star material. Remember, this is a supergiant star that has collapsed. Think like packing a snowball, denser and denser. The material of a neutron star is remarkably dense, so much so that if you took a normal-sized matchbox and packed it with neutron star material, it would weigh approximately 3 billion tons. I want you to look to the skies and ponder the weight of God. He flicks those things like marbles. Now, Matt stole my thunder, but I'm going to read these passages anyway. Romans chapter 1, I want you to hear these again. Romans chapter 1. What can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. If we can see the stars, we are without excuse. We must acknowledge there is a creator, or else we're denying reality. Let me read this again to you. And by the way, I'm not complaining when I say that Matt stole my thunder. We need to hear this over and over. Colossians chapter 1, he, Jesus, the Christ, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. By him, all things were created in heaven and on earth. By him, neutron stars are created. Everything in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. The neutron star spins 600 times a second for the glory of Christ. The Milky Way is as big as it is for the glory of Christ. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That neutron star spinning around all heavy, it's not falling apart because somehow the Christ holds it. So let it have a little weight to this truth that he is the head of the body, the church. He's the head of us. The same creator of the universe is in charge of us. When we gather in his name, the same God. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. And for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of the cross. When you look at Jesus on the cross in this way that we can hardly wrap our minds around, you're looking at the creator of the universe. Now, I have a third passage in my holster here. Matt didn't read this one. John 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. You're like, man, we know this one. Hear it again. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. And without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Let me skip down again to read you this. The Word became flesh and dwelt, or tabernacled. I want you to have that word echoing in your mind. Tabernacled among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. I want you to look to the skies to ponder the weight of God. And then I want you to focus. Let the sun wrap you in the warmth of God. So of all that we see in the skies, nighttime, daytime, we get a focus on the sun in the middle of verse 4. And I want you to let the sun wrap you in the warmth of God. In them he has set a tent or a tabernacle for the sun. Now he describes what the sun appears to be doing, which comes out like a bridegroom. If you're taking notes, you may want to circle the word tent and then circle the word bridegroom. It comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man, you may want to circle that phrase, strong man, like a strong man runs its course with joy. And I would encourage you, if you're circling, go ahead and circle the word joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens and its circuit to the end of them, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. You can't get away with it. You can't deny the reality of the sun. You certainly cannot survive without the sun. What we're being told in the text is this. I want you to listen with another layer with what I'm about to say. So God has taken care to prepare a tent for the sun. In other words, inside a tabernacle resides the light of the world. When the light of the world comes out of the tabernacle, he runs his course like a bridegroom pursuing his bride, like a warrior hero fulfilling his joy. Do you hear what I'm trying to lead you into hearing? And if you're kind of not familiar with the gospel, I may seem a little odd right now. Let me try to explain why I'm emphasizing it this way. Jesus said of himself, "I am the light of the world." We just read from John 1:14 that the Word who was God became flesh. That's when baby Jesus was born. And it says that Jesus, the Son of God, dwelt among us, tabernacled among us. The light of the world came and tabernacled in this earth among us. The Son, the light of the world, coming out of the tabernacle to run a course like a groom pursuing his bride. We're told in Scripture that Jesus is the bridegroom. We are looking forward to this day of eternity where we, the church, his bride, will be forever united with him. It says, like a warrior hero, a strong man. It's a word used for Boaz in the book of Ruth, who rescues Ruth and Naomi, pointing forward to the way we are rescued by our deliverer, our hero. Jesus says it runs its course with joy. We are told in Hebrews 10 that for the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. Let the sun wrap you in the warmth of God. Next, I want you to listen to the scriptures to hear the words of God. Okay? Listen to the scriptures to hear the words of God. Verses 7 through 11. I'll put it this way, used to be my favorite part of this psalm. I think the part about the sun, it got a hold of me this week, so maybe it's sort of the current favorite part. But verses 7 through 11, I mean, I just have always resonated with this part of Psalm 19, celebrating the facets of God's word using six synonyms is good too. But synonyms, I'm going to stop trying to say that word publicly right now. Of God's word, the law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true, righteous altogether. They are more to be desired than gold. All right, now some of you don't believe this. I'll be honest, sometimes I wonder, do I even believe this? More to be desired are they than gold? And I want to teach you a little bit about how Hebrew poetry works. Often you see something repeated, but it's really an enhancement, an intensification is a word one scholar uses. It says, more to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. He's not just repeating himself. He's heightening the stakes. The scriptures are more desirable, not just than a little gold dust, no, than much fine gold. Furthermore, sweeter also than honey. And then he does the same thing with his poetic license and drippings of the honeycomb. In other words, the sweetest, freshest experience of honey pales in comparison to the sweetness of God's word. Moreover, by them is your servant warned, and keeping them there is great reward. I want to persuade you to listen to the scriptures because they reward us when we do. Let me just use these synonyms to describe the Bible and see if this will encourage you to read it. It is perfect, it is sure, it is right, it is pure, it is clean, it is true. It gives life. It says he revives the soul. It gives wisdom. It makes wise the simple. It gives joy, rejoicing the heart. It gives light, enlightening the eyes, hope, enduring forever, and then a righteous reward. In keeping them, there is great reward. Those are the things that God's word promises: life, and wisdom, and joy, and light, and hope, and a righteous reward. These are the things that I think should persuade you to savor God's active word in your life. Just think about how God's word can give you life. Let me just try with this scripture to convince you. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Some of you are very aware of how perishable life is, how perishable our body is. Sweet sister in this church family passed away just 2 days ago. Perishable. Some of you are dealing with some reminder of weakness in life where you're wondering how much more you can take, how further you can go. Listen to scripture, revive you. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable. This mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And I need you to hear what verse 58 says. This is to revive your soul. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. We can love God's law, his perfect law, because it revives our soul. It gives us wisdom. There's a section of the Bible called the wisdom books. Think Proverbs. Men, I want to invite you to the men's retreat. We're going to be looking at Proverbs. We need wisdom. Men, we need God's wisdom. God's word gives joy. God's word gives light. God's word gives hope. It's the fear of the Lord, which is really the one word that seems to stand apart. Law, testimony, precepts, concept, commandment. Fear rules. Fear seems different. It was pointed out this week that fear is sort of the result, the reverence, the awe. It's the result of hearing and heeding God's word. It is clean, enduring forever. That's hope. The kind of hope I just read from 1 Corinthians 15. The kind of hope that we see in a book like the book of Daniel. So I want to invite you to the fall conference. Read the information about that. We'll be going over the book of Daniel. Getting hope from the word of God in October. And a righteous reward. Or some of you may need to be persuaded from the other angle. You know, you don't necessarily get all teased by life and wisdom and joy and light and hope and a righteous reward. We'll just think about the opposite then. Apart from the word of God, there is death, ignorance, sorrow, darkness, despair, wrath. Those are the opposites of everything that God's word promises. I want you to listen to the scriptures to hear the words of God. And then lastly, I want you to let the sacrifice perform the work of God. Let the sacrifice perform the work of God. What I'm talking about, we see through verses 12 through 14. Who can discern his errors? So here's what's happened. David has just encountered the word of God, which even more than the sun shines the light and heat of God into our souls. And he's like, whoa. Who can discern his own errors? He says, declare me innocent from hidden faults. There's a word connection. Verse 6, nothing is hidden from the heat of the sun. David says to God, declare me innocent from hidden faults. That word innocent is a word often used to describe a sacrifice in the Old Testament that would be given for sins. And there is more. Verse 13, keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. In other words, don't just declare me innocent from hidden faults, things we're not even aware of, but even the presumptuous one, it's the phrase, the high-handed sin. You almost get the idea, it's like sin while you're waving your hand, like I'm doing a sin. He's saying, keep me from that too. Let them not have dominion over me. He says, then I shall be blameless. That's another word that describes the sacrifices in the Old Testament law. They had to be blameless. Then I shall be blameless and innocent. There's that word again. I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. And then he says in verse 14, I want this to boggle your mind. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. First, that word acceptable, often describing lamb sacrifices. They had to be innocent, blameless, acceptable. But try to wrap your minds around what David is praying. Let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be acceptable in your sight. Here we go full circle to seeing something. Now it's God seeing into our depths. We start by trying to see into the vast, rich depths of the universe to see the glory of God. And now we're reminded that God sees into our depths, that he can see the words of our mouth. That's a pretty astounding thought. I'm never going to be accused of being the best listener in the world. I'm just one of those guys that from time to time, I don't listen as well as I should. Just yesterday in a meeting, I'm having to text some things, write some notes. I just say, okay, I can't write and listen. So everybody has to pause while Michael writes something, and then we can start again. I'm not a good listener. God is so good at listening, he sees your words. He sees the meditations of your heart, which in one sense can be a terrifying thought. I am not innocent or blameless. The words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart are so often not acceptable in his sight. I mean, just even more than I realize. We don't even realize how far short we fall of God's greatness and glory. We do not realize how often we think things or say things that are not acceptable to God according to the standard of his righteousness. We have to be driven back to verse 12. Who can discern his errors? None of us can. None of us knows how deep our own error and sinfulness goes. Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. We need God to do that. So the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart are often not acceptable in his sight, but I can seek God's redemptive words because he is my Lord. David says the very last phrase, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Commentaries point this out. I was jealous when I realized I did not see this at first myself. God's name changes in this psalm. Verse 1, the heavens declare the glory of God. That's El. That is the standard term for God, the majestic one, the transcendent one, the creator. It is very appropriate because it is celebrating God as creator from verses 1 through 6. But then it changes in verse 7. The law of the Lord is perfect. That's Yahweh. The testimony of the Lord, the precepts of the Lord, the commandment of the Lord, the fear of the Lord, the rules of the Lord. Then verse 14, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. 7 times the name Lord appears, the number of completion. That is the covenant name for God. It's the name God gave his people when he rescued them, he saved them, he established his relationship with them and said, I am Yahweh. David says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Yahweh, the one who has graciously established covenant relationship with us. He's my Lord. He is my rock. This thought of rock, can you think of when the word rock occurs in the Old Testament, when God is using a rock? His people are thirsty. He says, hit the rock. Strike the rock. Wound the rock. Living water will flow out of it. The Lord is my rock. The Lord is my Redeemer. This is the word also used to describe who Boaz would become in the book of Ruth. He is the kinsman redeemer, the one who could pay to salvage relationship with someone in need. The Lord is my rock and my redeemer. He is the one who came in the form of a baby, innocent, blameless, and became the acceptable sacrifice for my sins. And I'm simply going to close by celebrating that truth in my life, that God is my Lord, he's my rock, he's my Redeemer. I know that's so true for many of you in here as well. I hope that as I celebrate, you will celebrate with me. Let me say some comments to those of you who are not followers of Christ. I believe God has sovereignly drawn you into this gathering with us. I don't know who you are. You know who you are. Maybe you're realizing that that's who you are, that you're not a follower of Christ. I want you to know that it is through Jesus Christ, the Son of God, that you can have salvation, that you can be redeemed, that you can experience God as your Lord, as your rock, as your Redeemer. That's what he accomplished on the cross. That is the sacrifice that performed the work of God that I want you to celebrate. Paying for our sins, redeeming us, so that, believe it or not, we can then be declared by faith in Christ as innocent, blameless, and acceptable. And I want you to put your faith in him. On that card that I asked you to hold close, there's a way that you can indicate interest in talking about that right here on the back, right here towards the top. You can check that you want to give your life to Christ. If you do that, we'll try to set up a time to talk, to share the gospel with you again, to see what the Holy Spirit is doing in your life. I want to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And as I pray my gratitude, I just want you in your spirit, you join in prayer to God as well with your gratitude. God, I want to thank you. You are the God of heavens. You are the God of the sky. You are the creator. Cultures worshiped the sun. You created it. Ancient cultures worshiped stars and the moon and clouds and the ground and rain. No, you created all of it. You are gloriously heavy. With your finger, you can flick away a neutron star, no matter how heavy it is. I praise you for your greatness. I want to praise you for being my rock. I can anchor my soul, my life, my hope, my faith in you and in you alone. You are the one wounded in my behalf to provide living water, struck to save me from a certain death. God, you are my Redeemer. You bought me. with your precious blood. You have revealed yourself to the world. You have revealed yourself even more so through your word. May we desire it more than much fine gold and more than the drippings of the honeycomb. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand as we respond to God's word this morning?
This is my Father's word, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass, He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world, the battle is not done. Jesus who died shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one.
Receive these words from Psalm 119, verses 1 through 3. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep His testimonies, who seek Him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in His ways. Amen.